Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship. It's so good to see everybody here today. Just two quick announcements before we begin. First, this is officially VBS week. We've been doing a lot of work leading up to this week, and it's finally here. We've got one more big hurdle to get over before we actually kick the events off, and that is to transform this whole area into an underwater adventure and bring all of the stuff that Tina and her crew have been working on for the past month in the small fellowship hall up to here. We're going to be doing that after worship, after the second service. If you're available, we would love to get as many hands as possible to help us out with that. We'll probably start that setup around 12 o'clock, and the more people we have, the quicker we will get through that. So we thank you all for your support for VBS this week. Please continue to keep it in your prayers, as I believe we now have 49 or almost 50 kids registered for that. So thank you all so much for your support. Secondly, you may notice Dan Glerno. Dan, if you want to give a quick wave here. Dan is with Mass Media. Give me the last word. Designs, thank you. Mass Media Designs, they're working on our new website, and he needed to get a couple actual still photos for the website. He was able to take some of the images from the video that was taken back in April, but some of it wasn't quite working out super well, so we've got him snapping a few pictures. So pay no attention to Dan. That's the only time that we're gonna say hi to Dan. If you could, please stand. We begin our worship service today in the name of God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may worthily love you and greatly magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say that we have no sin, then we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment of silence to be brought to confession, recognizing our need for a Savior. Confess with me, most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, he forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins, in the name of God the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's join together in singing our opening hymn. You can find the words on the screen or in the green hymnals in front of you. The Church's One Foundation, number 369.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. O God, pour out upon us the Spirit to think and to do what is right, that we, who cannot even exist without you, may have the strength to live according to your will, through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Before you're seated, ask that you turn to a neighbor to share a sign of the peace.
Our first reading this morning is from the Old Testament book of Jeremiah, beginning with the 23rd chapter. Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says to the shepherds who tend my people. Because you have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not bestowed care on them, I will bestow punishment on you for the evil you have done, declares the Lord. I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and will bring them back to their pasture, where they will be fruitful and increase in number. I will place shepherds over them who will tend them, and they will no longer be afraid or terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord, our righteous Savior. Here ends the first lesson. The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 11 to 22. Paul writes, "Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenant of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit." Here ends the second lesson.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all that they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And so he began teaching them many things. When they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret and anchored there. As soon as they got out of the boat, people recognized Jesus. They ran throughout the whole region and carried the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages, towns, or countryside, they placed the sick in the marketplaces. They begged him to let them touch even the edge of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. This is the gospel of our Lord. What does it mean for God's word to be for you. We talk about this a lot, but what does it mean to be for you? This is going to be the main focus of our gospel text today, as we're about to get into arguably one of the most well-known miracles that Jesus performed in feeding the 5,000, but we're actually not going to get into that miracle quite yet. Because what Jesus does leading up to this miracle is so significant and so often easily overlooked. But from his actions, we see the importance of what it means for God to be for you. The comprehension that God is for you is foundational to our understanding of Christ's words, of Holy Scripture, and of God's purpose in your life. And so we're going to focus on verses 30 through 34 in Mark 6 today. And then we're going to skip over the actual feeding of the 5,000 into verse 53. And so this is kind of going to be part one of a two-part sermon, in which next week we'll loop back and cover the performing of the miracle, the feeding of the 5,000 as documented in John's gospel. Now, just prior to these events, the disciples have returned from this mission trip that Jesus has sent them on. He sent them out in pairs to travel the countryside, and they were calling for the repentance of sin and proclaiming forgiveness, all on Jesus' authority. And so they're out there preaching, and they're casting out demons, and then something incredible happens while they're doing this. It works. Their message is heard and received. And so the disciples come back, and they're pretty worked up about it. And that's the awesome thing about proclaiming the gospel, is to be able to bear witness to those moments when the Holy Spirit shows up. And he opens the ears with the good news of what Jesus is doing for the hearer. To watch faith be made, and those light bulbs come on in people's lives. Like, that God would use broken people, imperfect people, to go out and seek out other people just like them and share the good news of what Christ is doing in their life, of God for you, is incredible. And what it does is it kicks off this chain reaction, because when this happens, you want to see it keep going. And once you have this gospel word, you can't help but tell other people. And so the disciples come back from all of this, and Jesus takes them out to a desolate place, a place where they can gather themselves and rest. Because this preaching business is hard work. They're worn out, and they're tired, and this is actually kind of a cool little detail here that it says that Jesus takes them to this secluded or desolate place, depending on the translation of your Bible. The place that Jesus takes them to is the wilderness. It's the very same place in which Jesus goes to be tempted by the devil. It's the same place that John the Baptist operated his ministry. Like, the wilderness is not what you would think of when it comes to peace and rest, at least not for the people of their day. It might be for us, but it was not a safe place. It was a place of chaos and uncertainty. It was considered a place where evil spirits roamed and generally would have been avoided by the average person. But here's Jesus taking the apostles to get peace where most people don't think that peace can be found. But even in the desolate places, Jesus and his disciples are unable to get away from the crowds of people. The crowds see Jesus and his crew get aboard the boat, and they head off to the wilderness, and the crowds run ahead to meet him there. Clearly, the disciples have done their job. They're preaching it hit home with these people, and they have responded. And if you thought Jesus was popular before this, things are really about to get taken to the next level. I mean, think, Jesus is taking a straight line, cutting through the sea, and these people, this is how desperate they were for him. They ran around on land and still got there before he was able to get there. It's incredible. And so the result of the disciples' preaching is that it freed people. These people were in dire need. And a major part of that need was that they didn't think that God was for them. Life wasn't going well for them. They were sick. They were poor. They were in desperate need of help. All signs in the world were pointing to God had ignored them. Or at the very least, they had done something to incur God's wrath or his indifference. And it's not a far stretch for someone to get there. You know, that's kind of the general thought process behind pretty much every other world religion. It's law. It's eye for an eye. It's you know, you reap what you sow. You do something bad and you incur the wrath or judgment or punishment of whatever God. Or you do something good and you're blessed or maybe you're just left alone. It was in you know, these other world religions, it was believed that, you know, people were responsible for catering good favor towards the gods. And so they would have to make a sacrifice, or they'd have to do something in which to earn a blessing, or take some sort of action to curry favor with the various gods. And so if they were in a bad position, then clearly they had done something wrong, and God was not for them. But that's not so with the one true God. Upon arriving to this desolate place, Jesus is met with this horde of people desperate for him. And he looked upon them, and instead of being annoyed or frustrated or like, guys, I just need a break, he has compassion for them. The Greek phrase here used to describe the compassion that Jesus felt wasn't like that Jesus felt bad for them, or that he pitied them. But rather, Jesus was moved to his core. It's almost a literal translation where that his insides ached for these people. His stomach churned and hurt for them because this was a horrible scene. And what made it horrible was that Jesus looked at this crowd and recognized that these were people who were like a flock of sheep with no shepherd. You know, a shepherd provides the needs for their flock. He watches over them, and he protects them. And when you have a shepherd watching over a flock, then the sheep are comfortable, and they're content in their environment. They're not on edge or worried because they know that the shepherd is there. But that's not the situation of these people. You know, like a flock with no shepherd, this crowd is left scrambling. They're groping around this old world, questioning whether or not they have peace. They don't feel safe. They feel exposed and unprotected. They think that God's not for them. They think that he might even be against them. And that's certainly what the devil's trying to convince you in the world of, that God really isn't for you, that you need to put your faith somewhere else, that your safety and peace will ultimately come from somewhere in the world. And we too, like the crowd, easily get caught up in this line of thinking. And so what does Jesus do in response to this? Well, he doesn't feed them or provide for their physical needs right away. And that's why we're stopping short of the actual miracle, because this can quickly get covered up. But the most important thing is he teaches them. He gives them his word. Now, when we hear the word teaching, it's different. When Jesus taught, he would have taught on what we know as the Old Testament and the law and the prophets. He would have revealed man's sinfulness and rebellion and our need for a Savior. But then revealing the promise of a Savior has been fulfilled, that indeed the Savior was here. And he sees the real need of these people. They need to know the truth. They need to know that God is for them. Jesus sees a flock without a shepherd, and so he gives them a shepherd. And in that, you see the very nature of God's heart towards you. It ails God to see people not hear his word, which is why he sends Christ. And so Jesus, through his teaching, creates this reality for people. That's the big difference between Jesus' teaching and our teaching. You know, when we teach a person, you know, we give information for them to take in, and they decide whether or not to take it or leave it, right? But when Jesus speaks, it happens. His words create and make it a reality. He speaks, and the dead rise. He rolls back the tomb and calls out, "Lazarus, come out of the tomb." And he responds and comes out immediately. He goes to Jairus' house, where his daughter has died, and he grabs her by the hand and says, "Little girl, get up." And she does. Nature obeys his word. He silences the storms and calms the waves. The darkness is overcome by the light. Demons are silenced and cast out. There is no questioning or arguing or deciding when Jesus speaks. He speaks, and it happens. It's with his words that faith is made. You know, Paul tells us faith comes through hearing. That's why we're called to be proclaimers and preachers. It isn't about presenting people with facts and information about Jesus, but about telling them what he is doing for them. It's giving a promise on the merit and on the authority of Jesus. It's plagiarizing his words that he first gave, rooted in his creative and authoritative power. And so then we jump ahead. And we see in verse 53 the response to Jesus' speaking. You see faith in action. You're watching the effects of faith being created by Jesus' words. You're seeing the reaction to a promise received. The disciples and Jesus cross over the sea again, and soon they make landfall, and people just begin to pour out to them. The whole region turns out. They're bringing their sick. No matter where they went, villages, cities, the countryside, the people flock to Jesus. And the apostles' proclamation that cast out demons and cast out the devil's lies that God wasn't for you has gone viral now. Everyone is now turning out to Jesus, and they're healed and they're saved because they trust God's promise in Christ that God's actually for them. All who trusted that God was for them were saved. Just like the woman who reached out and touched the fringe of his cloak and was healed. It wasn't her action of reaching out, but it was her faith that made her well, trusting that God was for her. That freed her from her needs. That gave her new life. And so the very same promise that was made real for the people then is the same promise that is given to you today. This is what it means to know that God is for you. We are beaten down by the difficulties and the fears of this world. We buy into the devil's constant message that our future's at risk. We're too quick to equate that our physical or material blessings are a sign of God's goodness and graciousness. But God has sent Jesus to dispel that myth, to give you the truth of who he is and who you are in him. He's giving you a promise that extends past this old world, a promise that not even death can silence. God is claiming you as his own. You are his. This is not done by any merit or action of your own, but it's done by his choosing. He's chosen you, chosen to have mercy on you. He's been moved to compassion for you. He has seen your striving and clutching at things of the world for meaning and purpose. And he puts all of that to an end. And he gives you a new identity and a new life. He gives you this through word and sacrament. It's in those two things that you can have complete and total assurance that God is actually for you. He speaks his promise to you. He sends someone to speak it to you. You don't have to try and look deep within yourself to judge. You don't have to wonder, have I done enough? Do I pray enough? Do I look like a good Christian enough? Am I spiritual enough? Is there some other sign that I can find to really prove that he's for me? It was first in your baptism that he gave you this promise of new life and the forgiveness of sin. The only question you ask, did the water hit me? Yes, God for you. His promise in a physical element, in the bread and in the wine, he reaffirms that promise that he is for you. Did you eat? Did you drink? Yes, God for you. The Holy Spirit brings you a preacher, not by accident, but by God's very will to confirm and assure that he is for you. Even in the midst of uncertainty and a world crumbling around you, you could lose every last possession you own. Not even death can change or silence this promise. When everything in the world fails or inevitably goes away, this truth remains. You have a shepherd. The Holy Spirit has brought you here to hear Christ's reassuring words of mercy and grace for you. God is for you, no matter how much the world tries to tell you otherwise. You are fellow saints and members of the household of God. You were built on the foundation of what Christ has done for you on the cross. It is by your faith that you have been saved, and on account of Christ that you are made worthy. He is filling your hearts with compassion and grace, with assurance that you are never alone, never abandoned, never outside the care of your good shepherd. This is God's word for you. Amen. Let's confess together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Before we move into a time of prayers for the church, I'd like to ask, are there any joys to lift up today? Good things happening. Marilyn, yeah? So 87 going on 39? Is that what we're celebrating here? Awesome. Happy birthday. Jacob's birthday is tomorrow, too. Happy birthday, Jacob. You're not 39 going on 80-something, are you? No? Okay, good. Other joys. Yeah. Ethan, turning 20 on the 25th. Closing in on that golden birthday, man. Any other joys? Yeah, Gene. Glad to have Gene's family in from Denver here. Anything else? Do we have any additions to our prayer list today? Nothing. All right. Let's pray. Holy Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this day that you have given us, or this blessing, this gift. Lord God, we don't want to squander it. We don't want to seem ungrateful. And so we thank you, Father, for all of the good things that you give us, Lord, those that we recognize and those that we don't even realize happening around us, Father. Lord, we thank you for the obvious blessings in our lives, Lord, for for birthdays, Father, for family coming in, for our friends. Lord, those relationships that you give us, Father, that just mean so much to us. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for providing for us. Lord, for meeting us at our needs, for getting us through each and every day. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can come to you and unburden our hearts. Lord, that you take those things that weigh us down and you put them upon yourself. And so, Father, we lift up all of those who are in need. Lord, we thank you that you know the need of every person who is on our prayer list. Lord, we pray for Kelly, for Missy, for Sarah, for Tilly, for Jimmy, Julie, Mike, Debbie, Mark, for Larry, for Gary, for Ashley and Christopher, for Dave and Eric, Lord, and for the Lucht family. Heavenly Father, meet them at their needs, Lord, according to your will. Lord, may you rally around them. Lord, bring someone in their life to give them and remind them of their word of promise that you first gave them. Lord, sustain them, minister to them, and be gracious to them. Lord, in your mercy, Lord God, we thank you so much that you are for us. Lord, that we don't have to run around in circles and try to qualify ourselves before you. Lord, we pray for all these sirens that are going on too. We heard the main siren go off, and now these police or emergency vehicles going by. We pray for our first responders and those who are in need, Father. And we thank you, Lord, that you uphold them and are with them. But God, we thank you that you are for us. Lord, that you will not forsake us. Lord, that you have qualified us and called us worthy and good and chosen us to have mercy and forgiveness. Lord, may we in turn respond to this good news, this faith that has been worked into our hearts to go out into the community around us, Father, and do the very same thing for others that you have done for us. We pray this all in Jesus' most precious and holy name. Amen. This time we'll receive our morning tithes and offerings. Please stand.
Gather the harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened the hosts of heaven, we praise your name. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Now we gather together praying the words that our Lord and Savior has said. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You can be seated. This morning we'll be receiving the sacrament in the center aisle. If you follow the leading of the ushers, walk down the aisle, you receive a piece of bread, you can eat that right away, and then you'll receive wine. The red colored is wine, and the yellow is grape juice. And we invite all of those who are so moved by the Holy Spirit to join us in receiving the sacrament. Please stand. And now may this, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. In the name of God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's join together in singing our closing hymn. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.